the creator of spaces of beauty and places of useful activity. We're called to be good stewards of the resources of this community. We seek wisdom to make good decisions. Guide this council and prosper the work of the staff who serve the citizens. Keep us in safety and in good health. Amen.
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 Please join me in
pledge. Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Ms. Gillen, the roll, please.
Gary Hodge, Ward 1.
Here.
Jay Stepp, Ward 2.
Yeah.
Louis Tonsmeyer, Ward 3.
Here.
Betsy McDaniel, Ward 4.
Here.
Diane Tate, Ward 5.
Here.
Lori Pruitt, Ward 6.
Here.
Okay. I got your back, Diane.
Thank you. Thank you, Gary. We got the program done aware of it. We are off of the dance all year. That's always a good thing. Our first order of business is the approval of our council meeting minutes from July 16th. And council, you've had these well in advance of tonight's meeting. And the chair will take any edits or additions or deletions or turn on a motion would be in order. I'm sorry.
Everybody, please make sure your microphones are on. Sorry there, Jason.
Mayor, I looked over the minutes. Make a motion to approve with no deletions or additions.
Second. Got a motion, second. All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Minutes are approved. The next minutes will show that Carrie led us in the pledge. So, and thank you for that. We do have a series of public hearings tonight relative to property tax millage, and if Reinhardt could get us started off with those.
Yes, Honorable Mayor and Council. Property taxes for the city of Carterville MNO are used for general city government operations, which include police, fire, recreation, public works, etc. We were required this year to hold three public meetings. This will serve as the third public meeting, I'm sorry, public hearing. State law requires us, since we are have elected to leave the millage rate at 1.38 mills instead of going to the rollback rate of 1.298 mills. Again, this is the third public hearing. And just to let you know, with the increase or leaving it at the 1.38 mills, there'd be a slight increase overall taxes of almost $75,000. And to break it down even a little bit further on down the road, for someone who owns a house that's valued at $100,000, there'd be a $3.28 increase over the rollback rate. I do recommend the approval of the Carswell M&O property tax millage rate of 1.38 mills for 2015.
Thank you. Any questions for Tom at this point? Thank you, sir. I'll open up a public hearing relative to the City of Carswell M&O property tax millage. Anybody wishing to step forward, speak for or against, may do so at this time. And seeing none, I'll close that public hearing. And it is up to you, Council, for what action you wish to take.
Motion to approve.
Second.
All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Motion carries unanimously. Next item, please, Tom.
Yes, Honorable Mayor and Council, the second public hearing is for the City of Carswell School System. Their board has recommended to go with a rollback rate for 2015 of 16.82 mills versus the current rate of 17.23 mills. I recommend the approval of the City of Carswell School System property tax millage rate at 16.28 mills for 2015.
Okay, any questions on this item? Thank you, sir. I'll open up a public hearing for the city school system property tax millage. And again, anybody wishing to step forward, speak for or against, may do so at this time. And seeing none, I'll close the public hearing. And again, Council, this is at your discretion for any actions you'd like to take.
Motion to approve.
Second. All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Motion carries unanimously. The Cartersville Business Improvement District property tax millage.
Yes, Honorable Mayor and Council, this is for the Cartersville Business Improvement District. They have the DDA kind of oversees this, and they have recommended to go with the rollback rate of 2.42 mills versus 2.50 mills for 2015. I recommend the approval for the Cartersville Business Improvement District property tax millage rate of 2.24 mills for 2015.
Okay, thank you. Any questions on this item? I'll just note relative to this that this is a tax millage that the downtown merchants impose on themselves that gets rolled back into the development of downtown.
Yes.
Thank you. I'll open up a public hearing for the Cartersville bid property tax millage. Anybody wishing to step forward, speak for or against, may do so at this time.
Here, I have a question. I probably should know this, but how is this collected?
It's collected the same way as all ad valorem taxes are. The county collects it, and then they distribute to Tom's office, then Tom's office forwards the portion to the DDA from the total ad valorem taxes.
Well, we actually keep it
down. Oh, keep it.
Okay.
It down.
I like an answer. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Anybody else wishing to step forward, speak for or against, may do so at this time. And seeing none, I'll close the public hearing for the Cartersville Bid District property tax millage. And again, council, at your discretion.
Motion to approve.
Second.
All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Motion carries unanimously. The final one is the Cartersville Geo Recreation Bond property tax millage.
Yes, Honorable Mayor and Council, this is a tax, if you will, that was approved or voted in by the citizens of Cartersville in November 2014, authorizing the city to issue bonds to pay for some expansions and renovations and improvements to the parks and recreation buildings and properties. This is a 10-year period, payback period. In order to make the scheduled bond payments, the city is assessing a property tax millage of 1.1 mils for 2015. Millage rate will fluctuate over the 10-year period as, of course, the bond payments go up and down. And I recommend the approval of the Cartersville Geo Recreation Bond Tax Millage Rate of 1.1 mils for 2015.
Thank you. Any questions? All right. Open a public hearing relative to the Geobond property tax millage. Anybody wish to step forward, speak for or against, may do so at this time. And seeing none, I'll close that public hearing. And once again, Council, it is at your hands for discussion or for vote.
Motion to approve.
Second.
All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Motion carries unanimously. We have a couple of first reading of ordinances tonight. We won't vote on these, but we will get informed about them. And Mr. Sanders, if you will get us started off on the first item, please.
Thank you, Mayor. This is a first reading, and we got a request to evaluate the intersection of Glen Cove Drive and Waterford Drive for a multi-way stop. Wade Wilson, the city engineer, did the evaluation and considered the traffic volumes, the pedestrian volumes, bicycle volumes, and looked at the warrants in the manual and uniform traffic control devices and determined that, yes, a multi-way stop was warranted. And so to put in a multi-way stop there, we had to do an ordinance revision, and that's what this is the first reading for. So
can you share with us just a little bit about the traffic counts, what kind of accidents counts are out there? I know that a number of members of council have heard from people out there that may or may not want it. And so I know you go by objective standards that are in the book, but I think some of the details on that might be helpful as we inform ourselves on it.
You know, the first place we always look is the manual and uniform traffic control devices, which has been adopted by all 50 states. And yeah, the purpose of that is so that traffic control will be standardized and, you know, across the country. And for multi-way stops, it says in part that, you know, multi-way stop control is useful as a safety measure in certain conditions, and which include not only vehicular traffic, but where there's pedestrians and bicyclists and all road users. And there's a lot of verbiage here, but it goes on to list that one of the criteria that can be considered includes a intersection of two residential neighborhood streets of similar design and operating characteristics where multi-way stop control would improve traffic operational characteristics. So it specifically lists this exact, you know, kind of intersection. The volume on Glen Cove is about 3,650 cars a day. We've done weeks and weeks worth of traffic counts out there in the past because that's probably the most studied road in the city of Cartersville. we've received numerous requests to study that. It's, you know, the only way in and out of the subdivision, so the traffic counts are pretty consistent over the years. You know, there's been a home or two added, but that's a count that's not going to go down, you know. But so 3,650, just for comparison's sake, 3,650 vehicles a day. You know, the road we've been talking about for the last few weeks, Douthat Ferry, has about 5,500 cars a day on it. So Glen Cove Drive actually has 70% of the traffic that Douthat Ferry has on it, which is a lot for a residential road. At Waterford, you know, about half the subdivision is on the right and about half the subdivision is on the left. There may be a few more houses on the right, but so the split is, you know, maybe 60-40, 50, you know, it's somewhere close to 60-40, probably with a little bit more traffic to the right. But there is a large volume of pedestrian traffic, bicycles, joggers, runners, people that use Dellinger Park, that go there and run and then go back home. And there is a crosswalk that's on an uncontrolled leg of the intersection. And so that's probably the biggest gain in safety by installing the three-way, the multi-way stop would be far, one of the biggest gains is at that crosswalk. Because now basically you have uncontrolled vehicular movements there. So when you control that, you know, it adds a measure of safety for bicyclists and pedestrians.
I know that one of the concerns that have been brought up, at least in some of the conversations that I've had about it, is the concern that traffic is going to get backed up on both sides of Waterford Drive spilling into Glen Cove, and that it's going to take a lot longer to get out of the subdivision. Is that a concern of yours?
No, we, you know, obviously when you have a stop condition, there's going to be some delay added, but it's a turning movement. You're either turning right or turning left if you're on Waterford, on to Glen Cove. So you almost have to come to a stop now. And in fact, the people coming from the older section, the older part of the subdivision, they're turning left. A lot of times they have to stop anyway for right turning traffic. They've got to yield. So, you know, we don't think there's going to be much added delay at all. You know, the 3650 number is both directions combined. So that's about 1,800 each direction. So what we look at when we look at that intersection is the approaches to the intersection. So the Glen Cove approach has about 1,800 vehicles, and the Waterford approach has about 1,800 combined. So, you know, it's going to be 900 or, 1,800. But basically you have half the traffic on Waterford that at that intersection that you approaching the intersection from each leg than you do on the Glen Cove approach. So you would expect that the queues would be about half of the queue at Glen Cove, because it's already a stop condition. And we don't really have a problem with traffic queuing up at Glen Cove. So, you know, we wouldn't, if you have half that amount on Waterford, you know, we wouldn't anticipate, you know, you could estimate that you would have half the queue on Waterford that you would have on the Glen Cove approach, and we don't have a problem there, so we wouldn't anticipate a problem on Waterford.
What about accidents at that intersection? Is it dangerous? Is it more or less than any other place? Does the level of accidents warrant this, or is it?
Well, we actually, we checked with the police department. There's been one accident in the last year that, you know, we deemed preventable by installation of a multi-way stop. We didn't do a full, like usually you do about a 6-year history. We did, because the intersection met the criteria so well with the MUTCD, we didn't even look any further into the accident history. The person that did request it, I think, you know, when they called, you know, they've had cars ended up in their yard, you know, so and they reported seeing, you know, several near misses, you know, horns honking and brakes, you know, people having to slam on their brakes. So we used the information they gave us too.
Thank you. Any other questions for Mr. Sanders on this? Thank you.
Okay.
Back to Tom.
I do know that I think there's at least one or two residents here. We typically don't do public hearings or discussions on this, but I know you spent the time to be here, and if you'd like to speak, I'll give you that opportunity. And if you would, when you approach the mic, if you please give your name and your address for our clerk, please.
Okay. Mayor, council members, my name is Bill Gamble. I live at 495 Waterford Drive. My real purpose in coming tonight, well, I did want to speak against it, but it was really more to find out why. And I've heard why from Ms. Sanders, and then I've also heard why from my good friend and neighbor that supports this. And I think a lot of the what Ms. Sanders was talking about in terms of a lot of reasons for this are also true at the other end of Glen Cove Drive, which goes on to Etowah Drive. That problem was solved when the city put in a cement divider. The problem that seems to exist at Glen Cove and Waterford are people that are coming at a higher rate of speed and taking that corner, and they're turning, not making a straight turn, but cutting across. If you had a cement divider there, everyone would have to come and slow down, maybe even come to a complete stop to make a true L turn. That's what you have to do out at the other end of Glen Cove and Etowah Drive. So I really wish that before the council made a final decision on this, that the city would look at that as a solution as opposed to putting a stop sign there. For me, it's just an inconvenience of having to stop. When you come in on, I come in on Glen Cove, stop, turn left. When I leave my house, I come to Glen Cove, turn right. If a stop sign goes up, I've got to stop every time. Now I don't have to stop because I have the right of way. I'm turning right there. And there's not been an increase in traffic. There have only been 5 new homes in the Waterford in the past 7 years. And one of those hasn't sold yet, it's unoccupied. So it's not like we've had a major increase in traffic in the last year or two or three, only 5 new homes in the last 7 years. So those are the reasons that I came to speak against it, and I hope you'll consider that, but particularly getting the city to do the study about the cement divider.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you for your comments. Anyone else?
Thank you, Mayor and Council. David Long, 90 Glen Cove Drive. Numerous occasions I've had children, teenagers, end up in my driveway, coming around the corner from Waterford onto Glen Cove. I have small kids myself, young teens. If they're in the driveway riding their bike, they would have been hit. There's been pizza deliveries across the street from me that ended up in the grass, and Miss Joyce Cagle also had a car that ended up in her grass. We need to do. Appreciate doing something, stop signs or a cement barrier to calm the traffic there. The city already knows that there's an issue to texture that little S turn through there to keep kids from going into the ditch, but I do favor some type of control, whether it's a stop signs or a barrier. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments. Anyone else?
I'm 18 Hastings, Waterford Drive. My wife and I moved and built 15 years ago. So we're very familiar with this particular intersection. It seems to me there's two concerns, efficiency and safety. And the efficiency goes way down, and despite some of the concerns of this other gentleman, my experience has not been that there's a huge safety issue at this particular intersection caused by vehicles not stopping. Right now we have one stop sign. If we have 3,600 some odd vehicles coming in there, So you figure 1,800 going out, 1,800 coming in. 1,800 got to stop. The other 1,800, probably 70% of the time, they're not stopping. So your efficiency is going to go way down. I just don't see the traffic patterns there in my 15 years to warrant a three-way stop. So those are my comments. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you. Anyone else? All right, we appreciate the input and the information. We'll take this up for consideration at our next meeting, which will be August the 20th. All right, thank you. Mr. Sanders, we've got another first reading that you have got to get us started with, please.
Yes, sir. This is a first reading that concerns Banger Street. It runs parallel to the railroad tracks and intersects at Carter Street. Georgia Department of Transportation has given CSX a grant to improve the equipment at Carter Street, put in gates, lights, and bells, and improve also the electronic equipment in the signal control box. The existing signal at the intersection is just lights and bells. There's no gates. So in order for the gates to be installed, it will require some encroachment into Banger. And Banger Street is already narrow, and so this would necessitate it being a one-way street. So we're proposing making it one-way north, which would be in the direction of Carter Street. So you come out at Carter Street. And this, like you said, this is the first reading, and we recommend approval.
Any questions for Tommy on this item?
Mayor, I do.
Okay.
Tommy, on Museum Drive, tell me what that does right across the railroad track. Is it one way part of the way, or?
It's on the opposite side of the railroad track. Is the Booth one way street?
Yeah. Is it?
Which way? She wants.
It runs in the same
goes.
Direction as the Booth, as Museum Drive, as after you go under the bridge.
That's what I was thinking. So we would have two one-way.
It would go away from town, basically.
That's correct.
Yeah.
So we would have two one-way on both sides of the railroad track.
That's correct.
Is there any reason why it wouldn't come the other way? I mean,
No, ma'am. Wade and I talked about that at length. It could easily be made one-way southbound.
I mean, I'm thinking public safety.
Well, that road kind of spills into spills into our parking lot.
Right, it comes out right here, right under the bridge at the fire station. So that was the main reason we figured northbound would be a better option, because you sort of got to know where you're going for northbound out. If we make it one way northbound, it would discourage less non-local traffic. In other words, somebody wouldn't get lost down here, because what would happen when the gates and bells go down, there would be a tendency for cars, instead of waiting on the train, to go southbound on Banger. And that would be one of the advantages of making it southbound, is you would have an outlet there. But the only problem with that is you're going to be dumping them, you know, right here into a parking lot, basically. So it's not really an ideal situation to route traffic, sort of encourage traffic to come this way. And that's the reason we decided to go northbound. But I mean, we don't really feel strongly about either direction. And I think you could just as easily make it southbound as northbound.
CSX doesn't care.
No, they don't care. I don't care. If y'all tell me what you want me to do with us.
I mean, I didn't even know that road was there until Tuesday when I saw this on the
stand.
But who uses that road?
Well, the biggest user of it used to be the business that's right here, but now it's vacant. It was a fire restoration business, and they used it a lot because they had just past the building was a fenced in area where their trucks staged and where they
How they'd head out,
loaded up and headed out from. But now there's one house, there's one residence on the road, and then there's an apartment complex that does dump out into Banger, and then there's some businesses that have a rear driveway. Those businesses all have access to Irwin Street, but they do have rear accesses to Banger. But it is a very low volume, you know, just you could count the volume on your fingers and toes. Yeah.
And the apartment complex has alternate.
Yes, their access is on Irwin Street also.
Discussion interesting here.
Yes, it is actually. The other point I would make in having it run that way is if you do have that commercial property, I think it would really impede the ability for anything to go there if you did have traffic coming that way because the parking for that building is that far down the road, you wouldn't be able to come this way.
Right. It would you know, their only access to their gated area would be to come in off of Carter. Because if they came in from this direction, they would they would be going the wrong way down a one-way street. So
is that building for sale? Is that?
I have no idea. I guess so. If there's nobody
it is vacant now.
So okay. Wait, make sure. If we have the direction going north, then that helps that commercial building because they would have access to their full parking lot, gated lot. But if we had it coming south, they could not.
Well, they would have to come off of Carter to be able to get to the lot that's the gated area beside their building. Mm-hmm. They would just have to go all the way around. You know, they have parking in front of their building. It's right here under the bridge. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, if somebody needed to go from their front parking lot to their rear parking lot, they would have to go all the way around to access the same piece of property.
Anybody else got any other questions? We got 2 weeks to look at this and drive that road in both directions.
I'm going on that way tonight. I'm gonna see that road for the first time in my 36 years.
Very good.
Well, hope don't try to come south.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
You can go either way.
I'm gonna go both directions, see which way it's
Thank faster. You. Mr. Sanders, we're gonna move on. You've got the next item.
Yes, this is a deed of dedication of right-of-way. City Storage on Morningside Drive is doing an expansion and to have the roadway width meet our current standards, they needed to deed 10 additional feet to us on the southern side of the street, and we approve accepting this additional 10 feet of right-of-way.
Okay. Any questions or discussion on this? Not a motion's in order.
Motion to approve.
Second.
All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Motion carries unanimously. Press on, please, Tommy.
Okay. This next agreement is with the developers of Carter Grove subdivision. And it concerns the top asphalt surface course in the streets in Carter Grove. Currently, there's no surface course. All the streets have the binder asphalt course on them, but no surface course. And earlier this year, we sent them a letter basically calling the bond. There's currently about a $600,000 bond in place. It's 500 and change, it's close to six. And in lieu of that, they have offered this agreement where there's specific triggers to when they get to a certain percentage of development, the streets would then be paved, and they've also agreed to up the bond amount to $900,000 and change. The original bond was done in 2010, and asphalt has gone up along with everything else, so the current bond's actually not enough to cover the work. So we think this is a favorable agreement for both parties involved, and we recommend approval.
Okay. Questions, comments?
When you had previously seen this, you had sent back to legal to take a look at the triggers and the dates, and those have been inserted, so you ought to be okay with it.
Okay. Any others?
Is there any, do you read into this in any way that there's, you know, basically guaranteeing future growth out there?
This is about protecting the city's interest in the streets and making sure that we don't have to repair the developer streets. That's all it is.
So just basically making sure they're keeping up there.
Right.
Exactly.
Tommy, I've got a question. Is that still being done, Carter Grove? Is it still being done in a pod kind of a concept? In other words, one builder will take several streets and And then...
Randy could probably answer that better than I could.
He's back there. You take off.
Randy, where'd you go?
Oops. Yes, ma'am. Pretty much. They sell... There's a builder that's acquired several lots from the bank. And that most of the construction going on now is not lots that were sold by the developer. They're lots that were acquired from a bank. But the developer has made a deal with the same builder that's building on the bank lots to buy lots in the future. And that was one of the things that took so long to get them to bring this agreement to us, is they wanted to make sure that they had a deal with that home builder to buy X amount of lots in the future. I think he's agreed to buy maybe 135 lots over a certain amount of time. And so they wanted to get that deal sealed before they committed to the triggers that would necessitate them spending money to pave the roads.
So it's 80% of a road, not 80% of the number of houses within what I'm calling a pod.
That's correct. We've got every individual road we've got listed in the agreement, and how many houses on it and how many lots. And when five roads, and there's a lot of small short roads, but when five roads get 80% built out, they've got to pave those five. It's bundled in groups of five. And on the second the second set of five roads that gets paved, that's when Carter Grove Boulevard gets paved. And then when the third set of five roads gets paved, that's when Belmont gets paved. Those are the two major thoroughfares that don't really have any houses on them, or have very few houses on them, but that most of the roads feed off of.
Kind of from a layman's point of view too, the importance of the 80% is that you've got traffic on it and it keeps the road from pumping, and it'll stay put once it gets paved.
Okay. Any other questions on this item? If not, a motion is in order.
Motion to approve.
Second.
All in favor indicate by saying aye.
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 Motion carries unanimously. Next item, please, Tommy.
Thank you, Mayor. This is, we have budgeted this year to do some maintenance painting on the Church Street Bridge. The structural steel has some rust showing through. It's nothing to be worried about, but it does need... The beams do need painting, so we budgeted for that. And in the process of getting ready to let this to contract, we talked with CSX and about what they would require of us, and we found out that there was a whole process of permitting, and that that we had to pay them funds in advance for their engineer to process the paperwork, and we had to pay for the flagging in advance. So they've requested $25,722 for administrative costs and flagging associated with the project. This was not anticipated in the amount that we budgeted for the project, so we are requesting that this money be paid for out of the 2003 SPLOST balance.
Do you recollect what we budgeted for this work? Was it 125 or 150? 125.
So, just so everybody knows.
Yeah. All right. Much. Any questions or discussion? If not, a motion.
Motion to approve.
Second.
All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Motion carries unanimously. Thank you, Tommy. Sam, you've got the next item, please.
This annual renewal of the city's membership in Northwest Georgia Regional Commission. It's $1 per. And that's $20,015. That's over $5,000. So I need your approval if we're going to do it.
Chair will entertain a motion.
So moved. Excuse me, guys.
Well, I'm the representative. I know. The city, so.
I'm sorry, I didn't give an opportunity for comment. I don't know if you, I figured this was.
Well, I'm in favor of it. I know the value of the regional commission, so I'd like to make that motion.
All right.
I'll second it.
All in favor indicate by saying aye.
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 Motion carries Sorry. Unanimously, I believe. Mr. Riggs, you've got the next two, please.
Yes, Mayor. The first one is an agreement to become a member of the Subscribe Regulatory Service, Compliance Service, and that's offered by the Municipal Gas Authority. Membership in that will help us stay in compliance with the federal regulations without additional personnel. This first year cost is $47,716 that we paid monthly. It'll go down next year because there's a, it's $13,000 or $14,000 setup fee that's in this.
Okay, thank you. Pretty straightforward. Any questions or comments? And if not, a motion.
So that list attached, that's all MGAG cities? Adairsville, Americus?
All those are.
No? Okay.
Austell's a member of this, and they're not an MGAG city.
Motion to approve.
Second.
All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Motion carries unanimously. Transco precedent agreement.
Yes, Mayor. This is the first step in getting firm capacity on the Dalton lateral. It's going to give us another interstate pipeline. It'll give us a new source of supply. If they ever expand their pine needle LNG facility in North Carolina, we'll be in the path. So we'll be able to get capacity there and use it in the winter. So I'm asking y'all to approve this agreement. And in addition, there's two more agreements that will come in time. One is an interconnect where we set up where we're going to get our tap off of them. And the other one is the firm service agreement.
Will it have cost savings to us? Is there a transport?
Right.
Right now, but down the road, obviously the capacity is one thing. The cost per therm.
Yeah, in the summer, the cost of gas of the Marcellus Shale is lower. So yes, we'll save money. We can take them to them in storage. What it'll be in 2017, I don't know. Because, you know, they're building.
If you did, you wouldn't be doing this, right?
That's right. You know, they're building LNG facilities to take that gas and be able to export it.
Okay. All right, thank you.
Mayor, you would need a motion to add the other two agreements to the agenda to vote on those?
I thought those were coming at a later date.
He's asking y'all to add those to the agenda and go ahead and approve those, subject to the approval of the city manager and city attorney's office.
Yes.
That is what he was asking.
Thank you for your direction.
I pay attention sometimes.
It just doesn't look like it. All right, so if there are no other questions or discussion, Council, you've been directed by our legal folk to include that as part of a motion if one is to be made.
So do we add the two? Yes. Discussion
item. Make a motion. They need to be added to the agenda.
Okay, I guess they've got to be added to the agenda for someone to make a motion on it.
To add them both to the agenda.
All right, got a motion to add, and I got a second. All in favor of adding to the agenda, say aye.
Aye.
Items are added. Thank you for catching me on that. All right. So now we've got these three items that would be subject to the approval of the city manager's office and of legal counsel.
Much to approve. All three.
Second.
Motion second. All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Motion carries unanimously. Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you for the gymnastics through that. Mr. Jones, you've got the next few.
Good evening, everyone. First up is a resolution authorizing the mayor to execute all documents necessary to apply to the Appalachian Regional Commission for a grant up to $300,000. Our intention is, if approved for the grant, to take that money and match or at least complete funding for a phase one water main replacement plan in downtown. I think we've discussed at length in times past that is something that's needed. The majority of the lines that we would be targeting with this first round of money, probably 60% of them, we believe, are original to the 1889 contract that established a water system in Cartersville. So it'd be a good first swing at getting rid of some of that stuff.
Wow. Are the sewer lines also down Main Street?
Absolutely. We have sewer in that area as well, and it will have to be addressed at some point in time, but we're going to take a stab at water first.
Folks, when we sat and talked with the folks that were doing the grant from the RDC, indicated that, you know, that they like to see multiple ones with different steps in it. So what I'm saying is if we got one of these, it would be viewed in favor to getting future ones, so there may be more money coming.
Right.
So they need to tear up the street twice.
Right. Not different areas.
Different streets.
Different
not
areas.
Street, but unfortunately, if you're going to repair the water line, you're going to tear the street up. But we'll try not to do more than once.
So, Bob, as I read this, if we did get this grant, it would be almost half of phase one.
Thereabouts. The price is going to float around a little bit now because there are a lot of unknowns in something that old. I have a map with lines on it that say that's where the line is. It's sometimes useful. So there's going to be some variability in where this line goes in. And as with the density of buildings down here, the density of utilities and everything is paved, when that path changes, the price is going to have a great deal of variability in it as well. But we think it will be around half.
And not to lengthen the discussion, but the number that we use, the big number that we use on the aging infrastructure, water and sewer that we need to replace is $20 million. So this just scratches the surface.
Motion to approve.
Second.
All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Motion carries unanimously. Thank you, Bob. Next item.
Next up, we have run into a problem with our old friend.
The Archimedes.
Yes. The pumps are appropriately named. Let's just leave it at that. In executing some of the previous work, you had authorized our painting contractor with sandblasting, and the metal on this one particular part of the pump is so thin that the sandblasting operation just blows holes through it. So there's just nothing.
Of course it did.
Yeah, if it makes you feel any better, this stuff that went in originally in 1974. So we've gotten our money's worth out of it. But in order to replace this part, we had bids taken out. Southern Machine was a low bid. It was actually the only bid at $6,385 even, and would recommend your approval of that.
Okay. Any discussion? If not, a motion.
Motion to approve.
Second.
All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Motion carries unanimously. Last one for you, Bob.
This is something we typically do in the new fiscal year. It's a restock of all the parts that we use to hold the water mains, sewer mains together. We're just refilling the shelves. The low bid came in for HD Supply at $6,694.73, and would ask your approval of that.
Okay, pretty straightforward. Any discussion or motion?
Motion to approve.
Second.
All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Motion carries unanimously. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Hasselbrock, you got a few.
Okay.
Mayor and Council, good afternoon. Come to you tonight to tell you that in accordance with the joint use contract that we have with AT&T and Comcast, we're required to do a pole attachment count of everybody's attachments on the poles, and we do this every 5 years. Work through ECG to select a third party that represents all the companies. So ECG helps to accumulate the price and the performance of the contractors, and they've tentatively selected UC Synergetic out of this group of contractors to perform this work. And AT&T and Comcast and us are all in agreement with the selection, if you so choose to use this company. But they're going to go to every pole for $1.60 per pole and identify attachments on the pole. And there's approximately 5,000 poles in the city that we're attached to, or everybody's attached to. So this project will be about $8,000. It will hinge on the number of poles they visit, but it's going to be approximately $8,000. And we pay up front, and we'll get reimbursement from these other companies. So we're asking you to approve the use of UC Synergetic to perform this pole attachment audit.
Don, do we typically find someone using a pole illegally?
And yes, ma'am.
We do.
And then, well, there's a permit process for people to get on the poles.
Okay.
and they don't always do it. They'll just go, they don't always submit an application to us because there's, you know, we have to look at safety. There's, you know, there's so much clearance over the road that's got to be met, and, you know, sometimes this is not done, and they look for safety violations also.
So for this price, will they contact the person who illegally is there, or do they turn it over to you, John, or?
Well, they'll either be Comcast, we're on top, AT&T is on bottom, and Comcast is in the middle. Typically, what you'll have is Comcast will be low because, or AT&T will be low because Comcast may have gotten down at lower than they should be, and then, you know, AT&T is on bottom with no space. So they'll turn this report over to all three parties, and we'll take corrective action.
Any other discussion? If not, let's take a poll.
Pun intended.
Approval.
Second.
All in favor, indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Paul doesn't love it.
I'll be here all week. I'll try the bill. Next item, please, Dan.
Okay, the next item involves the selecting a right-of-way clearing and maintenance service crew, and this is a contract that we use ECG to bid out the bidding process, and what they've done this year is just extend the existing contract by 1%, and so we're asking to use the same contractor we've used for the last 10 years, and that would be Trees Unlimited. They're out of Cave Springs, and during the storm they offered us additional assistance. So, you know, they were the selected bidder. They've been with us 10 years, and so for the 1% increase, we feel like it'd be the thing to do to continue using them.
Questions, comments, or motions?
Motion to approve Trees Unlimited as the best bid.
Second.
All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Motion carries unanimously. We've removed the Parkway Play systems. If you've got a copy of the agenda, there's some further consideration and some clarification on that. So we won't take that item up tonight. Ms. Bolander, here you are.
Thank you, Mayor and Council. This is the annual invoice from Civic Plus, the company that is our website management company, and it is for $12,696.43, and it is a budgeted item.
Okay. Any discussion? If not, a motion.
Motion to approve.
Second.
All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Motion carries unanimously. Mr. Porta.
Yes, Mayor and Council, I'll bring before you a two-factor authentication system for us to provide additional security for personnel to log into their computer systems. Basically, this is a toggle or a number will be provided. It comes randomly, goes through every 45 seconds or so. So the employee has to key in their name or password that they have plus this number to get into the computer system. The cost to provide these tokens is $17,940, and I recommend approval of that.
All right. Anyone?
Motion to approve.
Second.
All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Motion carries unanimously. Before we get to the citizen survey results, we do have a couple of items to add to the agenda. Chair will entertain a motion to add those two items.
Move to add them, please.
All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Motion carries. Items added. Mr. Porta.
Yes, Mayor. The first item is the Friendship Plaza Pavilion that the City Council approved going in-house, and Public Works Department's working to build that. But we're still going to use Clowers Electric. That submitted a proposal for $5,000 to the electrical work out there, and I recommend approval of Clowers Electric to do that work on the pavilion.
Okay. Questions, comments, or motions?
Motion to approve.
Second.
All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Motion carries unanimously. Next item, please.
The next item is a letter of intent for underwriting services with Raymond James. The recently where you approved the Transco President Agreement.
there's going to be a cost for us to join up with Transco, and then there's going to be a cost for materials and labor to get the pipeline built to that. We're looking at about $7 million approximately to get to that. We provide that service out there, and there's going to be some bond underwriting fees. So we're looking at about a $7.5 million bond issue. That cost is going to be funded in the future year, but you recently passed a gas rate increase for that, help pay for that debt. But before we can have a discussion with Raymond James to discuss this potential future debt, which will be next fiscal year or towards the latter part of next fiscal year before it's finalized, we'll need this letter of intent for underwriting services approved.
Yeah. This is what Gabe, same person with Lord,
is. Yeah, this isn't authorizing the bonds, this is authorizing talking to talking to them about the bonds. Okay. Any discussion? If not, a motion.
Motion to approve.
Second.
All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Motion carries unanimously. Mr. Grove.
Yep. Little piece of citizen survey. We've done this every 2 years since 03. Gives us indication of trends in citizen perception relative to our services and the quality of life in the community. It's plus or minus 5% around any one point. First one up is safety services. One thing that this does in addition to rating those over years is it gives normative comparisons to other cities in the nation. So that will give you a relative sense if they're high or low. These are all similar to national norm, except for emergency preparedness, which is higher than the norm. That's the one at the top. Next one is mobility services. I won't read through all these for you, but again, you've got the rating since 03, normative comparisons, and this is probably because we're lumped in with communities that do have full-blown bona fide bus service. The transit and bus service is rated lower than the national norm. Next one is natural environment services. These are all similar to national norms, and again, you've got the ratings over the years there for those. And the last one is built environment services. Again, the ratings for each of these. And I do recall some of these had historically been below the norms, but these are all at national norm.
What is that? So we just, utility billing, I just knew that we're now measuring?
Mm-hmm.
It says utility billing, we only have.
Oh, that is new. That's new in 15. That's only got one thing. Yeah, the relative number of bars will show you how many years that we've been looking at those, and some of them obviously have less than others. The last slide is economic development. This shows you the rating over the years, and this one's higher than the national norm. If you'll permit me, there is an item too that we need to bring up to speed on in the sinkholes.
Please proceed.
You got the stuff on that? Let's do the pictures first. What you see here is the beginning of a sinkhole that opened up Thursday night. Had a trailer fall in it. That's what you see at the top up there. Dimensions, it was probably about 45 feet across and 30 feet deep. This one did hit some small gas lines, so it kept it from going in the hole. That was Thursday. And we got a picture. And this is the other one. This is between, I don't know if you're familiar with the area, this is in the general area of the gas department, near where our refueling for all city vehicles and for school buses are. And this one opened up between those two buildings back there. You can see, you leave it there. You can see the cracks going up the side of the building. That's a block building. So the building was threatened. This one was a little bit different. Our engineers told me in the classic sense, the first one was really more like a true sinkhole where the created a void below and the top fell in on it. This one was a little bit different, and it kind of rippled, and I think there was a electric pole in the middle left that we had to take out. These involve power line, gas lines, a major sewer line through the area. The strategy that we pursued was to work on digging those out and stabilizing it by putting back riprap and rock and good dirt materials. We're obviously losing the back building, and we're in discussion with insurance relative to whether or not that would be covered. They will not cover any of the refilling or any of that stuff that's going on. Right now, show me the cost, will you? And I don't know if you can see these, and I apologize. I've only got a couple of these sheets. We're at $417,000. That's a combination of rock, GeoHydroTech, Remtech Environmental. If we had to offload the fuel that were in those tanks, I know I got a text from Kerry one day because we had the roads closed in that area, but we were afraid that the vapors might cause something explosive as we offloaded that. Of course, we've got expenses to Ladd's Farm Supply, Yellowstone Mining, and then we also have some estimates in that sheet. That's kind of where we're at on it and what's happened. Where we're going beyond this point is we've got a geotech consultant coming in to do seismic tests of the area to determine if there are any more voids in the area so that we know it's safe. I did take former Assistant City Manager Jerry Milam on the site yesterday, and he told us what it used to be like. The area where the gas administrative building and the shop is are both locations of old buildings, so we're pretty sure that those aren't on fill. In addition, the power substation located nearby too was the location of a building, so those probably aren't fill either. Oh, there's what's that do? I want to make sure that what we're doing out there, though, that you're fully informed as to what we're doing and the expense that we're incurring. We will need approvals on the GeoHydroTech that's going to do the seismology stuff. Bob's got a sewer line through the middle of this that's going to need to be fixed and or rerouted. We'll need approval on those two, plus the amounts that we spent for Vulcan, Remtech. And I guess we could come back and get the asphalt as we put that back in. But I want to make sure that we got authorization to do what we're doing. We've kind of gone ahead and got into it because we had to. And I will say that this is a real good effort. Of course, we all work closely together during times that are not emergency situations. Yes, I will. But water, public works, gas, electric, fire, police, all worked real well together. Safety was of the public and of our folks was utmost important. And I gotta give props to the folks at the county. They brought in some big equipment, stuff that we didn't have that helped us out. I've called over there a couple times, and I think the commissioner was out, but conveyed our sentiment. I mean, you know how well things are when they're operating good, but you really, I think, get your mettle tested when something like this happens. So wanted to disclose all that to you, and if you've got any questions relative to it, I'll try to answer it, or Tommy or other folks in the room can help. And we'll need some kind of approval on this stuff, funding sources. We'll use gas reserves and water reserves to do the work in those two areas, and hopefully we'll get some good news from insurance to replace the building. So that's kind of my thought relative to what we're going to do. These aren't budgeted items, and we can't try and squeeze them out of the budget. So
is the building already down and gone?
It is not down. It's still there. It's got
Yeah, I know it's going, but.
Is that, you know, insurance wise, so they're not liable for sinkholes?
They do have liability for sinkholes under our policy. However, there are certain exclusions, and they are waiting for the results of the geotech people to make a determination if the insurance company feels that those exclusions apply. In other words, a sinkhole caused by an earthquake, just for example, is not covered under our insurance. Sinkholes caused by other things are covered under our insurance. It's just how the policies work.
So if we had an earthquake and caused a sinkhole, and we lost tractors and pipes.
I have no idea without reviewing those specific policies and seeing what the riders are and having those reviewed. But we're told that they won't pay for the refilling of the holes, but they may possibly pay for the building. And of course, we've got the local agent involved. We've been talking to One Beacon, and yeah, we're doing that.
Sam, you and I talked about this briefly, but I was so impressed. I mean, this was an emergency. We didn't know how far this sinkhole was going to go, and so after our meeting Tuesday morning, I went down there. I was really impressed with every single department that you just mentioned, Mayor. I know everyone had to sign in. The fire department signed you in, signed you out. Someone was always with you. Nothing was taken for granted. Every single thing was very careful. And I'm always proud of our departments, but particularly that day, I just sat there and watched and said, how lucky can we be?
Yeah. And I know Tommy's guys were down there at 10 o'clock last night working to fill some of those holes. So they've been working overtime. I'd be lucky to remember that there was even a traffic manual if I worked as much as you guys have the last 4 or 5 days. So
there must have been 50 trucks. I mean, there's a lot.
The bigger truck. I got a text last night about this time, and there were 6 pieces of equipment on the site. I guess you got to look at this from the upside, you know. If that was going to happen, the good thing is nobody got hurt, and if there was a building down there that we're going to have a problem with, you know, maybe we would have a chance to upgrade it and fix the place up a little bit.
So, just one last question. Mm-hmm. I didn't hear any mention, it looks like we're not going to have to hit our own general fund reserves. We're going to use reserves from the different enterprise funds for...
Well, there is a sewer line that runs through the middle of the property, so that's why I thought water. Right. It is the location of the gas department, so that's why I thought gas. General fund, if you remember, when the real number that you need to look at is the auditor's number. And if you recall when we had the discussion with the auditor last year when they got through, we'd hit the general fund balance 2 years in a row. Last year to complete the public safety building, so we probably don't want to do that.
I'm just hoping we weren't.
Yeah. Okay.
That would be great.
It's not our first option, but it might be if we're forced into it. I mean, you can't look into the crystal
ball. Well, I mean, yeah.
It had to explain what's the cause of sinkholes.
Well, you know, I asked that. I asked Wade, who's our engineer, and he says it's the geology. I think that's... Tommy knows. He's going to tell us. That may be a bit like a neurosurgeon looking at your brain and telling you that.
And I can add just a little bit to that. I mean, generally in this region, below the soil, there's a layer of limestone. And that's also concurrent with the water table. So as the water, limestone's pretty soft. So as the water table goes up and down, it takes the limestone out with it, which leaves a void. And the soil will bridge over that void, but once the void gets so big that the soil can't bridge over it, it falls in. And then that creates a void right under the surface. And so, like the first picture you saw, that asphalt and top couple of feet of soil will bridge over a void in the soil until it gets so big that it can't support itself, and then it caves in. So when they say it's geologic, it's a typical... You know, that's the typical sinkhole scenario in this area. It's due to limestone.
And that's the reason we want to use a seismology test to make sure that there aren't any more of those kind of things down there waiting to cave in.
That's correct. Yeah. And I had, right before I came to this meeting, Wade talked with GeoHydro, and and they have detected an anomaly in their preliminary findings. So there's probably going to be some more bad news forthcoming.
What location? Do you have any idea?
The line that they detected it on was the line that's behind the building. So
can you use the pointer?
Which building? Show us which building.
The building is cracked. So it would be between South Bridge and the building, right there where she's got the cursor. So now that's very preliminary. You know, he really didn't even want to say anything. He needs to get back and run everything through the computer, but
That's not in the location. Point out where the substation is, up in the corner. So it's far. It's ways away from that.
But we'll have. It wasn't very big, I don't think. But it. I think he said it was around a 6-foot void.
That's not surprising. I think we thought it was under the building anyway.
Well, that line was along the back of the building, so it could extend under the building. They just. They've got to look at all the data.
I think from the looks of the building, we probably thought there was something going on under there.
Yeah.
And that building's going to come down one way or the other. We've made real sure that we kept people out of there until we had this looked at. So anyway, good job, y'all.
Thank you. Any other questions or discussion on this?
We
need an approval.
Question. We foresee that some of these costs will be passed on to the citizens of the city?
No, we'd look at reserves.
Reserves?
Yeah, I wouldn't look at increasing anything. It just means we have less money.
I'm going to ask you that because this is going to be probably in your newspapers.
You're not going to cover this, are you, Mike? You're right. That's part of the reason we're talking about it, to make sure people understand what we're doing and what funds we're spending. Yeah,
and
you're right.
Waiting for the phone to start ringing,
Sure. That's one of the reasons I wanted you to know.
And you said we need approval?
I need approval on the things that I listed on the spreadsheet.
So about the expenses
you need
to this
the
point?
Do you need the full amount?
No, because some of that's an asphalt estimate. Approval of GeoHydro and the stuff that we've spent in Vulcan Quarry, Remtech, Godwin Pump. I think the rest of those are. Oh, and the water contractor for Bob.
So you just need 50 something?
Would it be.
That first total?
I'm just asking, would it be easier if we were to approve an amount up to for this meeting? Or is it. We could always do everything retroactively at the next meeting.
If you wanted to approve the estimate that we've got so far on the sheet and those amounts listed, that'd be great.
I just want to give you all as much flexibility to do what you got to do.
Yeah, well,
absolutely.
Okay, so just this amount here?
Yeah, well. And
before 17?
And the amount, yeah, with the.
How about we say an amount not to exceed 500,000?
Okay.
Does that give you all the latitude you'll need
to
do?
Well, I don't know. We'll get into it.
I mean, if we.
You think we'll get into more than that down there or something else falls in?
I'm talking about in the next 2 weeks. Okay.
And also, too, I didn't disclose this to you. We had the discussion about what we thought the overtime would be relative to everybody. Overtime and benefits, what do we think, 20,000, 25,000? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Just so you know, I want to fully disclose all that to you. Half a million, be fine.
So that would be my recommendation to council to make a motion in that order, but it's up to y'all to do whatever you like.
All right, I'll make a motion. I'll make a motion to approve the amount not to exceed $500,000 for the sinkhole evaluation and repair costs.
Second.
I got a motion second. All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Motion carries.
And certainly, if any of you all want to go take a look at it, just to.
I don't want to extend the meeting more. I think Sam and Councilman Tate said it great, but I do want to thank our departments. Department heads, every single employee for a job well done, and the excessive amount of hours once again going above and beyond to do a great job. Another special thank you to the county for doing the same thing and coming to our aid and providing some equipment when we didn't have the luxury of time. So it all happens when we all work together. Hopefully we don't have to repay them in kind, because hopefully they don't have anything bad like this happen to them. But if they do, rest assured, we'll be at the ready to extend a hand like we always are. If there's nothing else that needs to come for council, is there?
Motion.
Chair will entertain a motion to adjourn.
So move.
I'm going to watch the dog.
I'm on.